So my name is Sunil Paniket. I'm a member of the board of the American Humanist Association, and I'm here to introduce our keynote speaker for the last event of our conference. Now, some of you may have been to other conferences, but at least at this conference you've seen other speakers. You know, we've had academics, bloggers, grassroots activists, writers, performers, a lot of different types of people, and a lot of interesting things to see and hear. But what you're about to hear is something quite different. It's a first-person account of how a young person went about standing up for his rights, and with poise and dignity, stood against an overwhelming majority of adults, so-called adults, who you would think know better, against their ignorance and bigotry. I'm going to let him tell his story in his own words. But when I said, standing up for rights, it wasn't even a figure of speech. After you hear him speak today, if you feel compelled, which I'm sure you will, to know more about him, there's a lot of information out there, including a great documentary about his struggle. And you'll see him standing up 3 or 4 years ago when he was just 14, in front of his school board, and advocating for himself, while all the adults in the room, all you could hear was ignorance and small-mindedness. So before I turn it over to him, I just want to read you a quote from his mother. Transgender rights are something that a lot of people have difficulty getting their minds around. So as you listen to him, it'd be great if you can keep in mind what his mother had to say about this. His mother's name is Deirdre Grimm. There's a lot of misconceptions about what transgender means, and it's a hard concept to wrap your head around. I don't really have a problem with it being hard to wrap your head around. What I have a problem with is people not even trying to wrap their heads around it. So, fellow humanists, it's my high privilege and distinct honor to introduce to you Gavin Grimm.
So I'm shorter than you. So, full disclosure, I will probably cry. I am not worried about crying. I'm not afraid to cry. I'm not worried about healing in public. Oh, there we go. I cried writing this. I cried editing this. I cried going through this. So, I will touch on what Sunil said in the opening remarks about my journey to stand up for my rights in my high school. But I'm going to first start way, way before that, when I wasn't in high school yet, and when I didn't yet know who I was, and when the struggle to exist in an evangelical environment was the single greatest threat to my life and my happiness. So, when my twin brother and I were born, we were two bouncing baby boys, him with a clubbed foot, and me with an erroneous birth certificate, mistakenly designating me as a girl at birth. A designation that would hang insidiously over me for the foreseeable future, dictating what I could and could not be, how I should dress, what I can do. I think he got the better deal. As I grew up in my Southern Baptist household with parents that held just about every prejudice, though not realizing it themselves, I realized quickly that this thing is not scrolling like it should be. okay, well, I'll just do it this way. I realized quickly that there were several aspects of the life that I was born into that I did not subscribe to. For example, at the tender age of 8, when I could no longer walk about 400 feet to my friend's house because he was a boy, but my brother could, I was hurt because he was my friend, but I was also struck by the unfairness of it. Alongside that feeling, though, there was something else. Something I didn't know how to vocalize any other way than by saying, I'm no different than my brother. They thought I was just some budding feminist, demanding equal rights on the playground, which itself was a concept most people in my life thought fit to ridicule rather than celebrate. Of course, I'm saying I'm just like my brother, he got the better deal. Please, I'll take the club foot, anything but this. My voice was drowned out by the noise of a culture not built to recognize a transgender child. To me, that phrase, I'm just like my brother, meant something deeper than what my parents heard. That phrase was my liberation. If only I could translate it into a language that they could understand. But I couldn't. And this happened again when I wanted to play football. And again when I didn't want to play girls' softball. Again, when I had to wear a dress to my sister's wedding. Again, when I held a girl's hand for the first time and I couldn't enjoy it because I felt like I was going to be sick because of the butterflies in my stomach and the anxiety of doing something that I had been taught was wrong. These were things I couldn't or wasn't allowed to do. Not because I was a girl, but because people didn't understand that I was a boy. And in a restrictive religious environment, it would be many long, traumatic years before I gained the language that would complete me. I remember so distinctly growing up in the church and asking questions that weren't meant to be asked. I was left with angry Sunday school directors, an unsatisfied thirst for knowledge, and worse, a deep, pervasive terror in the Creator. Could God see the doubt in my heart? Surely he could. He was God. Could he then see also how I played as a boy in my Pokemon games, or I played as a boy when I played pretend in the woods? Could he also feel my fluttering heartbeat whenever I saw my female neighbor who I had a big crush on? The latter few of these questions I dared not even fully form the thought of. The fear was there, but my mind was not my own. It was not safe from the prying eyes of an all-knowing and all-me-rejecting deity. Eventually, I stopped asking. Eventually, I stopped thinking. I accepted what my teachers and my family and my religious friends were saying, and I looked no further. And not wanting to be further rejected, not wanting to be more of an outsider than I was, I jumped in feet first. Youth retreats, Christian concerts, mission trips, proselytizing. I became what I hated. I even got rid of all my Pokemon toys. But regardless of my commitment, regardless of how many times I felt God, I felt like an outsider. It was a club I could never quite get through the doors of. And at the time, I thought the bouncer was Satan. And now I know it was my drive for knowledge. By this time, I would go right to the boy section of the clothing store while insisting that I wasn't gay. Then later, I would get on the computer and look through whatever LGBT media I could get my hands on until I had a shame-filled panic attack and deleted the search history. During that time, my pervasive fear of everlasting hell and a lack of privacy from my God had translated far more into real-world consequences. I was 10 or 11 and desperate to die. Along with that, I thought that I'd come home from school to find police cars in my yard, waiting to cart me away for the harmless, innocent little videos on YouTube or short stories on the internet. Not because any of this content was explicit, it never was, but because the content was LGBT. I was locked in a battle between wanting to stay at school, a place that caused me endless misery, so that I didn't have to come home to police cars, and staying at home to avoid the torture of school and avoid the panic of searching for law enforcement vehicles along the way. Around that time, I began looking more closely at the Bible. I would read and research it, looking for cherry-picked interpretations that could allow space for my identity as well as my God. I realized, though, that that was not possible. If I was to believe the Bible, it said who I thought I was at the time, a girl who liked girls, was wrong. But why believe it when it also made countless contradictions and claims both improbable and impossible? The word atheist came to me then, which was so taboo that it hadn't even been spoken of growing up. It was the highest offense possible. As I began to consume atheist content, that God fear subsided. It stuck with me for some time after I had admitted to myself that God was not real, but not in the way it had before. In fact, I still have the indoctrination of my upbringing hanging over me in some ways, but it was different, knowing that I wasn't the only one with these questions. It helped, although in a small, conservative town, I didn't have anyone in my life to whom I could express these thoughts. Losing my religion opened up the door for me to think more critically about who I was. Words like lesbian and bisexual and even transgender became part of my lexicon, not just words I'd reject as quickly as I could, out of mortal terror. I was able to play around with my identity in a way that my puritanical religious inner circle didn't allow for. And one day, it clicked. I was a boy. I was just like my brother, in the respect of us both being boys at least. My foot is fine. Finally, my feelings had a name and a place. Finally, the little boy playing in the dirt. Finally, the little boy playing in the dirt and mud and going through the woods barefoot to find frogs and snakes. The little boy who played Pokemon under a table lamp because back then, gaming systems weren't backlit. The little boy who hated pink and glitter with every angry bone in his body, but didn't know why, had been acknowledged and freed. I remember telling my mom that I wasn't going to church anymore. By then, I had chopped all my hair off. I had hopped from church to church, exhausting our options, always complaining that I didn't like the service or I didn't fit in. I got into the car that night after a youth group, and I told her that I wanted to stop going. "Well, that's the only place left. Where will you go? You have to go somewhere." I remember how angry she was. I said, "Church just isn't my thing." And she whirled around in the car and looked at me with a look that I had never seen from her before, and she said, "What do you mean church isn't your thing?" And I shrunk in on myself, but I stuck to it, and I said, "Church just isn't my thing." And I saw her face go white with terror, and I could feel her heart break, because in her mind, that was a sentence to hell. But she said nothing. And she turned around, and we didn't speak about it again. She probably remembered my previous attempt to ditch church when I said I wanted to start up a gay-straight alliance in my middle school. Only as an ally, of course, because I wasn't gay but had gay friends. At least that was my justification at the time. And of course understand that at this time I'm young and I'm understanding myself as what people are telling me that I am. I'm understanding myself as a girl who likes girls. "You shouldn't hang out with those people," she had told me. "You can go there, or you can go to youth group." And I thought, great, two birds, one stone. But when the time came for me to get ready for church, I didn't. She asked me why, and I said I had been given an ultimatum, and I had made my choice. My mother smiled then and hugged me, and she said, "Well, you can go to both," surely thinking she was doing me a favor. "But you'd better wear a hard hat inside," a favorite of hers. That of course meant that our all-loving God would bring the building down and crush me to death for my sins. And the hard hat would save me. So 2 years after I stopped going to church, I told my mom that I'm a boy. By this time, she was healthier. Our relationship was healthier. She would no longer say that neither gay men nor women should serve in the military, choosing now to stand up for me whenever somebody, my father included, commented on my boyish looks or lady-loving ways. Her response was to hug me as I sobbed, telling me that she loved me and it was okay, but that I couldn't tell anyone. My father was, of course, not used to the lesbian thing yet. But my 15th birthday was fast approaching, and I knew I could not be the birthday girl again. I knew that after bearing my soul to her and telling her who I really was, another birthday as the birthday girl would kill me. So we had many fights leading up to that day, my 15th birthday. Many horrible fights in which we both said things that we regret now. And the day before, we had a big one. And she told me then that I was determined to ruin everybody's good time and that I was selfish and I was asking for too much too fast. And so I went to bed as close to catatonic as I think I've ever been in my life, stricken with grief that weighed me down so intensely that I thought I would never recover. That morning, or the next morning, the morning of my 15th birthday, and of course of my twin brother's 15th birthday, I get up out of bed and I'm exactly as miserable as I felt when I went to bed. And she sees me in the morning, glum-faced, and says, "See, I knew you were determined to ruin this day for everyone. My birthday?" And so I wander over to the cake that she's purchased from Walmart, as is tradition. Just a plain little sheet cake, and it says, "Happy birthday." And then it has my name, and it has my brother's name. But it wasn't my name. It was the name assigned to me at birth, which she knew was not a name that honored me anymore. And so I lost my mind. I started screaming. "You couldn't have just left the names off the cake. Happy birthday wasn't enough for you. You had to do this to me. You're going to force me to go through this traumatic, horrific experience, and you didn't even have the forethought to not put the name on the cake. It's not my birthday. I'll be in my room when it's over." So I stomped up to my room and I shut the door, and I made plans to not ever have another birthday again. So about 20 minutes later, my father knocks on the door, and this is strange because I don't speak to my father, and especially not about emotions. And so my initial thoughts are to be hostile and to reject him and to tell him to get out of my room and go away. I don't want to see you. I don't want to talk to you, because in my mind, he's the problem. He's the reason I can't tell everybody, because he's not used to the lesbian thing yet. The week before, he cornered me in the truck alone and said, "You know, sometimes things become real if we call ourselves those things, and God doesn't like that." But I let him in my room, and he was very clearly exactly as awkward as one would be with a child who you don't talk about feelings with. And he said, "Your mom is telling me you're having some problems." And so, of course, again, my response is immediately, "Why do you care about my problems? When have you ever cared about my problems? Go away." But I realized that I could use this moment to my advantage. So I said, "Yeah, well, Mom said I can't tell you why I'm sad. So now it's Mom's problem." So my father goes and finds my mother, and she, by her account, is sobbing in her flower garden. And she unleashes the last 6 months of "We have a trans child" on him. And she said, "He is a boy. His name is Gavin. If you don't like it, I've already printed out the divorce papers." And she meant it. We had many long conversations where she assured me that if he didn't sign the paper to change my name, if he didn't sign the paper to get me my medication, if he didn't sign the paper to get my surgeries, she would leave him in an instant. More than 20 years of marriage, she would sever in an instant if it meant that her child would be happy and healthy. So, a little while later, knock, knock, knock. And I'm like, great, who is it now? And it's my dad. And now he's awkward, we don't talk, but also with a pale white face. So clearly my mother has told him a thing or two. And he says, your mom told me what's going on. And I don't understand any of it, but I love you anyway, and we'll get through this together. So, the secret's out, but what I didn't know is that in the meantime, my mother has also been calling up all of my extended family who were on their way to the birthday party, and most of whom, all of whom, are evangelical Christians, and she's been telling them essentially the same thing. My son is a boy. His name is Gavin. If you don't like it, don't come. You're not welcome in our house. My mother was willing to lose everything she cared about, to support her child. And so they filtered in slowly and awkwardly with cards, a couple duplicates because they all went to the same 7-Eleven to ditch the pink ones on the way. And my mother had called me down all excited, and of course I'm, you know, these emotions are complex, so I'm the secret's out and I can be myself and that's fantastic, but that doesn't fix everything. I'm still sad, I'm still depressed, I'm still living with the trauma of the last 48 hours, but of the last 15 years of my life. And I don't trust my family, my evangelical, conservative, racist, sexist, homophobic, I'm not racist, but family. I don't trust them to act and behave in a way that respects me. But it's better than them not knowing. So I stumble out of my room, and I'm still incredibly anxious and rather sad. But my mom is excited for some reason, and she tells me what she's done, and she tells me that she told everybody. And we cry, and she hugs me, and then she says, and look, come over here. And she waves me over to the cake, and I know exactly where she got the icing from, because I pried the blue version of it out of the back of the cabinet about a month before it was, like, stuck down by something that had leaked years ago. So she had fished out green gel icing, at least 4 years old, from the back, the deepest, grossest depths of our cabinets. But thankfully, green gel icing never expires, at least not that kind. And she had written Gavin on the cake. So my family filter in, and they're very awkward, and they're very uncomfortable, and no one is saying anything, and everyone's eyes are this wide. And my brother comes down the stairs, and my brother doesn't read the atmosphere even a little bit. And so he's beep-bopping around, hey everybody, it's my birthday, what's up, how are you doing, hey aunt so-and-so, hey uncle so-and-so, what's up, hey. And everyone's like, and he's just not picking up on it. And then he goes over to the cake, and he looks at the cake, and he says, why is the turtle's name on the cake? Because we had a pet turtle named Gavin, which my mother swears she did not know when picking out my name. I swear I'm named after a turtle. So now my brother is going over to my conservative, scared, confused family and saying, hey, the turtle's name is on the cake. Isn't that just crazy? And they're saying, because they're realizing what I'm realizing, and that's that Davy doesn't know. And so my mother looks at me, and I look at my mother, and my mother looks at me, and she says, "This one's yours." So I take him in the other room, and I shut the door, and I say, "Hey, look, that's not the turtle's name. He fished it out of a pond, by the way, and calls it Bubba, called it Bubba, which is probably why my mother is able to claim that she didn't know its real name. The turtle is no longer with us. He lives in the pond again now. It turns out turtle tanks smell. But I looked at him and I said, look, it's not the turtle's name. It's my name. I'm a boy. I'm transgender. And I don't know if he even knew what that word meant other than men in dresses as a punchline to late night comedy shows. So he looks at me, blank faced, and he says, no, you're not. And then he runs out of the room. But didn't mention the turtle another time that night. So that action taken by my mother, the decision to support her child above her self-consciousness, her worry about public opinion, the decision to risk losing everything important in her life is why I'm standing here today. And it's why I was later able to be discriminated against by my school board. Isn't that fun? So, when I was 15 and entering sophomore year of high school, I had transitioned that summer before, of course, and I had approached my school and I had said, hey, I'm a boy, what are you gonna do for me? With my mother by my side, and my principal, to his credit, did everything he could to respect me, and he said, you'll be safe here. You'll be respected here, and if anything happens, tell me immediately, and I'll take care of it. He said that he would have a no-tolerance policy on bullying, on harassment, on misgendering, on people using my dead name, which is the name I was assigned at birth, which no longer honors me, by the way. Essentially, he said that while it was going to be hard in rural Virginia, he would do everything he could to make it easier for me. And so I asked him if it would be okay for me to use the boys' bathroom, because at the start of school, when I was more afraid of my peers, I didn't ask to use it because I thought that I was in more danger than I realized that I was. And so I went to him and I said, hey, you know, it takes like 15 minutes to walk from my classes to the nurse's office every time you need to use the bathroom. Can I just use the boys' room? And he said something along the lines of, I have nothing here telling me you can't. And so I did for 7 weeks, and I was successful for 7 weeks. I had no physical or verbal altercations in the bathroom, despite it becoming popular to claim that you had a Gavin encounter, which ranged anywhere from I was sitting on the urinal to I cussed someone out in the bathroom. For those of you who have not experienced small town living, the rumors really can get very bizarre. I'm still waiting on the truck that I supposedly purchased with the Sioux money, by the way. So, without warning, after 7 weeks of using the boys' room with no incident, the school board, at their annual meeting, without telling my family, decided to open it up to public conversation about my genitals and my bathroom usage. My mother found out less than 24 hours before by chance from a Facebook post. And she stayed up all night getting resources about the suicide rates of transgender young people, getting resources about Title IX, getting resources about the rights of trans students in schools. And really, there wasn't a lot out there, but whatever she could find, she scraped together and she printed out 7 packets for all 7 board members and she handed them out. And she spoke on my behalf. And then I spoke on my behalf, and then 20 or so people spoke against me. and called me a girl and called me a freak and likened me to an animal and assured me that I would be raped, I would be assaulted, I was in danger. That's really what this is about. I'm in danger. And I belong in the girls' room, not the boys' room, because apparently we have children afraid to come to school now because of me, because I'm so terrifying. And so the decision is postponed to the next school board meeting, and at the next school board meeting, it is exponentially worse. Word has traveled farther, more people are there, people are angrier. And again, almost no one spoke on my behalf, except for myself and my friends and family that I had with me. I had people that I had grown up alongside, people that I knew in my community, people my mother had worked with, people that were friends of the family, people that I had known all my life stand up one after another, and talk about how much of a disgrace it was and how evil it was and how wrong it was, all the while changing their sentence structures to shove in an extra little girl this or young lady that. And the school board decided that night that I was either to use the girls' bathroom or any one of the three unisex bathrooms that they had constructed out of broom closets, an irony that I hope is not lost here, which I had not asked for and would not be using because, of course, I am not unisex, I am a boy. This kind of hatred and backlash stems exclusively, in this case, from an evangelical community. My lawsuit is ongoing. It reached the Supreme Court level. It came back down to the district court level. It may go back up to the Supreme Court level. It's been years, and it may take many more years, and I'm buckled in for the ride regardless. But one thing that cannot be ignored or overstated is the kind of violence that religion inflicts upon the LGBTQ community. It cannot be ignored or minimized because our church isn't like that. Almost everything I have described this evening is not related to, but because of, religion. And I am so tired of skirting around that fact. Religion does not have to take the form of guns or bombs in the hands of extremists to be violent. Religion is a killer, and often a silent one. One sanctioned by society that favors and ignores the abuse of institutional religion under a government that routinely refuses to enforce the separation of church and state. It is time for the age of regressive sky deities to be over. And it is time that we stop pretending that this is not a religious problem. Thank you so much, everybody, for listening to me. I take questions now, and I hope that this was a sufficiently pleasant final event for the conference. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Okay, please line up with your questions and please make it a question. I know I keep saying that. I just want to say thank you to you, Gavin. I mean, your story is amazing and compelling, and also so well told. We really appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for being here. John Metter from the Ethical Society of Austin. I'm an attorney, so I'm curious about what the remand was all about. Were this changes in Title IX related to Betsy DeVos getting in, or is it unrelated? And
so the remand was a result of part of our argument relied on Title IX and of the Obama era administration's interpretation of Title IX. Title IX details that basis on the discrimination of sex is illegal, and the Obama administration's position on that is that that included transgender individuals. One of the very first things the Trump administration did when he came into office was vacate that decision, that interpretation. And therefore, the courts felt that our argument was best remanded to a lower court.
Thank you.
A couple months ago, we went to arrest, worse than you, we went to a restaurant with friends of ours, and their daughter decided she was a boy. It was fine. And he had to go to the bathroom, and his older brother went with him. You know, she was about 10, and her brother was about 13, so he wanted to go to the bathroom, so he went with him. So I thought that was really sweet.
Oh, that is sweet.
Then I want to ask you, how's your brother handling this now?
So I'm going to be persnickety and say that in this case, that the child didn't decide that he wanted to be a boy. He was most certainly always a boy and just decided to vocalize it at that time. That would be the correct language for that. My brother is very much a product of our small town. He struggles with finding the confidence to go against the flow, and so he is very susceptible to small town mindsets. Our relationship is better now, especially that there's less pressure and less backlash for him in school because we're out of school. But, you know, my brother is still a very different bird than myself.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
Gavin, thank you for sharing that. I don't think you're the only one who cried a little during your talk. I'm interested to hear what your plans are for the future. You're an outstanding young man, and what can we expect from you?
I appreciate that. So, first and foremost, I do events like this fairly often. I love to do this. It's something that I do kind of as a living at the moment. And then in the fall, I'm going to be going to school. I am going to school to be a middle school English teacher. Thank you. I feel that as an activist, in my heart and now by trade, I would be doing a disservice if I wasn't using my my position in my career in the future as an activist. I feel that all teachers should be activists. And since I just care so very deeply about children and the rights of children and their ability to be happy and safe in school, I feel that it's something that will be incredibly enriching for my life. And so that's where I'm headed next. Doing events like these when I'm asked, and working on becoming a teacher. Thank you.
Hi, Gavin. You had mentioned that the thought of having a unisex bathroom made no sense because you're a boy and you should be able to use the boys' room. Our community center, the Gay and Lesbian Center here, has a gender-neutral bathroom, and I've looked at that as a positive move forward in getting rid of these bathroom issues. Also with single stall bathrooms that already exist, I don't really see why they have to segregate who goes into which ones. How do you feel about that?
Oh, let me be very clear. I think unisex bathrooms should be a staple of every place that bathrooms exist. I think, in fact, that it's a constitutional issue that there are not unisex bathrooms alongside the bathrooms for men and women, because you're creating a situation where a portion of the population who may not feel safe in either the male or the man or women's bathroom don't really have a safe place to go. And so I think that unisex bathrooms are never a bad thing when they are installed. However, forcing people into those spaces to segregate them from the non-transgender population is categorically discrimination. And so while I believe very strongly that the unisex option should always be there, it should not be the only place that trans students are allowed to use the bathroom. Thank you.
Hello, Gavin. Thank you so much for sharing your story with us. And as a person who was also raised in a religiously conservative family, I just want to thank you for your bravery.
Thank you.
It's very difficult to break away. Which actually brings me to my question. I still have some leftover, you know, God is watching and I'm sinful and please forgive me. And, you know, I work hard on that since I don't even believe God exists. But I'm really curious, like, how have you handled that indoctrination?
Well, at first there was a lot of anger. You know, I had my angry atheist phase. I think like many of us do, because religion very, very often leaves harm and hurt and scars and pain. And I think during that time of my life, I did so much extra work to move past those ideologies that I think it did ultimately help, although the anger, of course, is always destructive. But additionally, you know, it's been, I was 12 or 13. I 13 when I told my best friend at the time, who I had met through church, that I no longer believed in God, and 12 when I came to the realization. So I've had six or seven years to make peace with that, to move beyond that. But the deep impacts on self-esteem, on your expectations for yourself, that can be something that people deal with for the rest of their lives. And it's important to understand that it's okay. It's okay to still be working on yourself. It's okay to still have trauma and pain. And just be kind with yourself, be patient with yourself, and make sure you're acting within your personal boundaries and limitations, you know, and especially taking time to take care of yourself and remind yourself that as you are perfect.
Thank you.
Of course.
Thank you so much for your powerful story. I'm Charles Murn from Washington, D.C. Meetup. You talked about the impact of language, you know, pronouns, things like that, how and the idea of unisex bathrooms we've covered. Do you have an opinion about and do you advocate gender-neutral third-person pronouns?
Yeah, gender-neutral pronouns?
Yeah, and if so, do you have a preference for one version or another, or that sort of thing?
Yeah, so I think that people who do not identify as either male or female, or perhaps identify not exclusively or strictly in these ways, might use the gender neutral pronoun they, them, and theirs, which is a concept that many people struggle with. However, it is something that every one of us in this room have been using since we learned how to speak. Take the example of, hey, I'm going to the doctor. Oh, okay. What's their name? You know, you don't know if the doctor is a man or a woman, so you default to a neutral pronoun. This is something we've all been doing, and really, it can seem difficult at first, but it's really not difficult to incorporate that into your lexicon if you actually put the work in. Myself, I prefer male pronouns because I have a binary or strictly male identity. But as far as people who use non-binary pronouns that better honor them, I have no problem with that. I have no jurisdiction over what makes other people happy.
Hi, I'm Chris Rex. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Chris Rex, I'm the Vice President of Freethought Fort Wayne. And I had two questions. One, you said that you had a twin. I'm guessing a fraternal twin?
Yes.
Okay. So two, as a professor of biology, I'm just kind of curious if you've looked into either how you were or became a trans kind of person, whether that was something that was genetic or if it was hormonal or if it was developmental, if you know anything about that, about yourself or about transgender people in general.
Yeah, so for me, you know, it's not terribly important to me why I am who I am. Any more than it's important to me to know, you know, why I have dark curly hair or fair skin or why I burn if I spend more than 2 seconds in the sun. It's just part of who I am, and I have always been this way, and so it is more helpful for me to identify the sources of distress that result and try to take care of myself and transition into a body, into a space, into a life that makes me comfortable. There's so much speculation on what the cause of being trans could be it hormonal, genetic, what have you. I think there's a very good body of evidence to suggest that there is a genetic link, though of course we haven't identified the trans gene in studies of twins. A statistically significant amount of twin studies have shown that most often when one twin, especially in identical twins, in fraternal twins, the statistics are no different than normal siblings. But in identical twins, if one twin is trans, the likelihood of the other twin to be gender nonconforming or have an LGBT identity is much higher, statistically significantly high enough that there's reason to believe that there is a correlation. But beyond that, really, we haven't pinpointed a trans gene or a trans hormonal event or what have you. But of course, I think the importance is to respect people as they are and help them, help people in your life move through life in a way that honors them and makes them comfortable.
So we have time for one more question and no one's up here, so I'm gonna ask you a question.
Okay.
I know I've read that for trans teenagers especially, suicidal ideation is very high. But if one person, I think if it's a parent, that's probably the ideal situation. But if one person, an authority figure in their lives, will use the name that they want, that they prefer, that is their name, that reflects who they are, maybe it's a teacher or a coach, that incidence goes down dramatically. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to ask you, as a future educator, do you think there's a way that could be part of teacher training or somehow part of an education degree?
So I think very strongly that it should be, with zero exceptions, absolutely mandatory to have sensitivity training if you are going to be working with young people. Young people are vulnerable and they present themselves in all kinds of different ways, and that is beautiful and important, and they need to have that space to freely explore who they are. In my position, from my perspective as a teacher, gender and being trans and being gay, these are things that will be spoken about in my classroom. These are things that will never be a taboo. These are things that will always be respected. I will always be open with my students about these topics, regardless of fear of backlash from an angry parent. How dare you tell my children that some people are different? Okay, well, Deborah, sorry, but we have to respect all of our students. I also want to stress, I was recently contacted by a teacher I had in middle school. This teacher was the only teacher to recognize that I had a queer identity at that time, and would speak openly and honestly about it with me, and made a huge difference in my ability to graduate that year. And she contacted me recently and said, "Hey, I had a kid come out to me as a trans boy, what do I do?" And so what I instructed her to do, I said, first and foremost, it is not illegal to call him by he or by the name he's asked you to refer to him by. You can do that, you're allowed, I promise. It's not illegal to respect a child's wishes, regardless of the parent's involvement. And then also, many of these kids come from a place of insecurity, of not knowing a lot about their identity and their feelings, especially when they're younger. What I asked her to do, I said, would you please give him some options? Say, I can either continue calling you by female pronouns with the name on the roster, or I can call you with male pronouns with this name you've asked me, or I can avoid it altogether and try to not gender you or name you, and so therefore avoid humiliating or outing you. And she brought these suggestions to the child, and he said, of course I want to be called this boy name, and please call me he. And his mood has improved, he is doing better in school, he's still having a lot of challenges, but that made a big difference. So I can't stress enough how not illegal it is to respect a child. Just saying.
Thanks again, Gavin.
Thank you very much. I hope everyone's convention was fantastic. Thank you all for listening to me today. Thank you for the questions. I've had a blast, and hopefully you all have taken something away from this. Thank you so much.
Well, we've come to the end of the 2018 conference. I do want to thank Gavin for his courage, and I'm going to cry. Sometimes we just have to do our tears. You're so insightful. I know this has been a horrible journey for you. I am so grateful that you had parents who had the love that was required. And I don't want this to sound, I don't want you to take this wrong. So I don't even know what word to use to preface this. But I hope that the result of this journey, I have seen that the result of this journey has made you such an incredible human being. And so much more insightful, and so much more engaged with who you are and with how the world is than you would most likely have been without the journey. So I'm sorry that you have gone through it, and I'm glad that you can celebrate who you are, because I know we do. We are so honored. This has been a weekend where people have opened their hearts to us. They've shared their pain. They've shared their hopes. And they've asked us to engage. And I trust that as humanists, we will follow through to the best of our abilities to answer their needs. Couple of housekeeping items now, which seems so trivial after that enormous presentation. If you are going on the tour to see the beautiful red rocks and be with nature after being in this hotel for so long, there are still tickets available, and they're asking that you gather by the check-in kiosk in the lobby by 12:25. At this time, I would like to thank our amazing speakers who have given so much to us this weekend. That includes our awardees. Our attendees, you, for being open and caring and compassionate with what you have heard. And I know I've had my head whirling, what can we do? How can we position this organization to meet the needs of these communities as well as the needs of the planet? And I'm sure you're doing the same thing. If you have ideas, please, you can forward them to me at rhale@americanhumanist.org or anybody in the Washington, D.C. office. I'm sure we will welcome that input. I'd like to thank the AHA board, who has served with me for a very long time. And some of us are getting a little long in the tooth, but we're doing what we hope you want us to do. You've got an election coming up. Pay attention to the candidates and make your best choices there. The Humanist Society board, which has really come around in the last 2 years. We have such an organization there to be proud of now. The Humanist Foundation trustees are here this weekend. They're holding their annual meeting. You want to give Fred Edwards a big donation or a legacy gift? I'm sure they'll welcome that. The Center for Freethought Equality Board, the ones who are doing the political change as best we can. Our wonderful AV staff, the hotel banquet staff, who really did a great job during those banquets, slipping in and slipping out without being in our way. the AHA staff who have really picked it up for this conference. Thank you, Nicole, Jennifer, Melody, Meredith, Roy, of course, Emily, yes, Emily and Matt and Ron and Louie, Kristen. Some have been peripheral to our family for a long time, and now we've brought them in, and it feels really good. The volunteers, Las Vegas volunteers who have helped with this, and really Fred and Mary Edwards, who have held down the fort out there with them. Our celebrants, you, our chapter leaders, our social justice leaders, the SSA, and other exhibitors, thank you for making this, although a small, a most amazing and wonderful conference. Thank you.